Facebook, and we're also on YouTube, all at the same time. And my wife is tuning up her instrument at the background. You might be able to hear, but that's okay. What I'm going to do is read. And if you don't want to read, you want to just listen, well, that's fine too. But faith comes from hearing and hearing the word of God. Amen. Heavenly Father, let's just pray and give us the Lord. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, that we're here at this time of history. We thank you, Lord God, that we're here in faith. And Lord, we come boldly to the throne of grace to obtain mercy and find grace to help of a time of need. Lord, we need your goodness and mercy upon us. We need the anointing far greater now than we've ever needed it before. And we pray, Lord, that we be, you can teach us how to be led by your Spirit and to be led by your Word. For we know the Spirit and the Word agree, and that we come to terms with what the Word says. And by your Spirit, you fill us with your joy. We pray, Father God, that the eyes of our understanding will be enlightened, that we may know what is the hope of the calling, and what is the riches and the glory and the inheritance of the saints to us who believe. And I pray for the same power that rose Jesus from the dead to dwell within our hearts and minds, and make us more and more to be like Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. That's my prayer, and I pray that it'll be your prayer too. I just want to bring to remembrance a few things that we should know already, and maybe, you know, it might be news to some, you know, who knows who's watching this broadcast overseas. We know we say hello to Simon and a few of the others locally here. We're pleased that we do have followers, at least locally, but we have something like 6,000, approximately 6,000, and probably a whole lot more than that. But it's 4,000 on one list in YouTube, and another couple of thousand in Lichen. So if you're on Lichen, if you're watching us on Lichen, we appreciate your comments. I really appreciate it. And I haven't had time or permission really to mention anybody's name on the recordings, but I did say I was going to read out a few of the comments or reports that have been sent to us, and you know, there's been that many, it's hard to just select one or two. But I really appreciate the people that have sent their comments from places like Pakistan, of all places. You know, Pakistan is very a minority of Christians there, mainly Muslims, I guess, and across the border to India there, we've been hearing from them too. And I'd love to be able to say that I'm going to visit India before the end of this year, but you know, we are limited to finances, and really the Lord gives us power to get wealth, so the Lord is in control of that. So you know, with the Lord's willingness and with the Lord's blessing, I can say that I'm open to go to India around about October or November. And we have pastors here that like to join us in evangelism to Philippines, India, and places like that throughout the Southeast China Sea. We're open for that. But like I say, the Lord has to provide, but we have our faith out for that in that time. Okay, I'm going to read this morning you know, very often, sometimes people would voice their opinions about where we are at in God's kingdom and God's time clock, you know. And sometimes they'd voice their opinions and then look for an agreement. And, you know, it's not wrong to have a different perspective of what God is talking to you. However, one thing we all should agree with, and that is what the Word of God is saying. So that's what we're going to do today. We're going to read and let the Bible explain itself. I'm going to start reading from 2 Corinthians chapter 4. It says, therefore, now when you when you have a word therefore, it shouldn't go ahead with what you're going to read. You should go back a verse or two to find out what the word therefore is there for. And so we'll do that. In 2 Corinthians chapter 4, it says, therefore we have this ministry. Well, let's go back and find out what it's talking about. It says, nevertheless, this is chapter 3, 16, nevertheless, when I shall turn to the Lord, the veil shall be taken away. Now the Lord is that Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. But we all, with open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. Now we're going to read chapter 3 in a few minutes, but I'm going to continue. So he's talking about God's glory, and he's saying, therefore, seeing we have this ministry, as we have received mercy, we faint not, but have renounced the hidden things of dishonesty, not walking in craftiness, nor handling the word deceitfully, but by the manifestation of the truth, commending ourselves to every man's conscience in the sight of God. But if the gospel be hidden, and it's not really, but some people, they don't understand it, they don't understand why other people do understand. Well, we'll explain a little bit of that today. But if the gospel be hid, it is hid from them that are lost. So in other words, you have to be saved, you have to be of the same spirit that actually wrote the book. Now we know the Bible is written by men, holy men of God, that was led by the Spirit. Nevertheless, it's the same Spirit that rose Jesus from the dead that dwells within you and me if we're believers, and that Spirit should not be talking different things to somebody and different thing to you. We should all agree in the Word and in the same Spirit, all right? So, it says, whom the God of this world, it says, if the gospel is hid, it's hid from those that are lost. So you have to be of a born-again spirit to understand the Word of God correctly. 2 Timothy 2.15, I'm off again, I'm sorry. 2 Timothy 2.15 says, study to show yourself approved unto God, not unto man, but unto God, a workman that needeth not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Well, if you can rightly divide the word of truth, it means that you can wrongly divide the word of truth also. What's the difference then? Well, if you are a disciplined disciple of the Lord Jesus Christ, then the Lord will correct that which is wrong in you, if you're open for that, all right? Now, in whom the God of this world, and this is 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 4, it says, whom the God of this world has blinded the minds to stop them from seeing the light of the glorious gospel, who is the image of God that shine unto them. For we preach not of ourselves, but Jesus Christ the Lord, and ourselves your servants for Jesus' sake. For God, who commanded the light to shine out of darkness, has shined in the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. But we have this treasure in earthen vessels. Now, the God of this world that has blinded the eyes, obviously, is not the same God that we serve. So he's talking about Satan, or the God of this world, blinding their eyes to stop them from seeing the light of the glorious gospel. In other words, if your understanding is not up to scratch and you don't fully understand what everybody else seems to understand, it's because you need deliverance from that darkness. And that could happen to anybody. So if you today, I'm going to pray in a few minutes, I'm going to pray that you be enlightened, that you become a light, enlightened one. Now, in these dark times that we're living in right now, it's important that the light comes on, because things are getting drastically dangerous. I mean, there are people dying around the world with this virus, and that's all it is. It's a virus that we will overcome, and we'll overcome many viruses before, but this one seems to be killing a whole lot more people, and which I believe is a conspiracy, because really the overall people that are dying in the world hasn't increased. It's just that they put the coronavirus name attached to it. If you notice, there's many elderly that die first, and they're protecting their elderly. That's good. But, you know, they die through other ailments as well. They may have cancer, they may have sugar diabetes, they may have heart. It says in the Bible that people will die through heart failure and you know, more than anything else. But amongst the elderly, they are dying, yes, through the coronavirus, yes, but that's not what killed them. You know, what killed them is old age, when the heart attack, the cancer, and all the other ailments that they may have, you know. And one of the worst things that a person can do when they're old, I mean, I can talk with authority because I'm, you know, 72, and praise God, I'm doing well, because I'm fit, I'm happy, and, you know, God's looking after me by the grace of God. Thanks. And so the fact, one of the worst things you can do is when a doctor gives you you know, a bad report of your health, one of the worst things you can do is jump on a cruise and go around the world, because what you're going to do is you're going to get in a different environment, all kinds of different temperatures and all kinds of different bugs that you're going to be exposed to. And obviously that, you know, if your cancer don't get you, your sugar diabetes don't get you, and your heart failure don't get you, then the coronavirus will. And of course, what they do is when the person passes from this world, they say the coronavirus killed them. You see that? So there's no real increase in the number of people that are dying around the world. It's only putting a tag on it at the coronavirus. Now, I didn't say that. The experts have said that I'm talking to them. And over the internet, you can look up a conspiracy coronavirus, and you'll see men, learned men of God, or the professors that are in the world and the medical profession, they'll tell you, you know, that they've been told to put up, shut up, or get out, you know. And so as a lot of the nurses have left their job because they don't want to go along with this system that says, you know, people are dying with coronavirus. They are, but they're not really. They got other ailments as well. So it's only fear tactics. And if you fear, Jesus says, do not fear. About 32 times in the Bible, in the New Testament alone, it says, do not fear. Because fear is not faith. You can't please God with fear. You can't go to God and pray with fear. You got to go to God with faith. Amen. And this group that we are putting together now is called the Faith Restoration House Church. We're still in the house. But when we got enough supporters, we're going to get a building. And God's going to give us a building, I believe, you know, because this concept of Faith Restoration Church, the Faith Restoration Church, is not an old idea, or it's not a new idea, it's an old, the old original doctrines that are coming back into the church. We're going to bring them back into the church. People have got away from the original doctrines. Let's get back to the word. Okay. Whom the God of this world has blinded the minds to stop them from seeing the light, the glorious gospel, who is the image of God who shines in them. And we preach not ourselves, but Jesus Christ the Lord, and ourselves your servants in Christ's name. For the God who commanded the light to shine out of the darkness has shined in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. We have this treasure in earthen vessels. The excellency and the power may be of God, not of us. But we are troubled on every side, yet not distressed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. We're cast down, but not destroyed. Always bearing about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus Christ, that the life also of Jesus might be manifest in our bodies. That's what's happening now, that the real faith people do not get sick anymore. They've overcome the world, the flesh, and the devil. They know how to do that. They've learned how to do that. And it says in Hebrews that even their senses discerns. They don't have to discern anymore. Even their senses will discern the difference between good and evil. The senses, your flesh, will bear witness of what is right and wrong, spiritually, and what is sickness and what is not, spiritually. And so we've learned to listen to the Spirit so much that even our senses, our five physical senses, can discern the difference between the right and wrong and what is spiritually right and wrong. We can spiritually discern now. And this is the people that God's talking to and raising up now, a people that will be led by the Spirit and will see a manifestation of the sons of God. That time is now. That time is now where people are rising up in the Spirit and manifesting the glory of the Lord. Hallelujah. And so, always bearing about the dying of the Lord Jesus Christ and the life also that might be manifest in our body, for we which live are always delivered unto death for Jesus' sake, that the life also of Jesus might be manifest, made manifest in our mortal flesh. So then, worketh in us, but life in you. Yeah? The death worketh in us, but life in you. And we're dying to this world. We no longer have the desires of the world in us. And, you know, the Apostle Paul says, I don't know whether to be with you or go be with the Lord. It's more beneficial for me if I go to be with the Lord, but it's more beneficial for you if I stay here. Amen. And you know, there are people now are trying to make that decision. They're saying, look, the world has gone that dark. I don't know whether I belong here anymore. And they're preferring to be with Jesus than being here on the world. Now, anybody who's got that thought in their heart, I'm not the only one. God's talked to many people. But I'll tell you this, do not take your life, give your life. Give your life to Jesus today. You know, there's lots of veterans that have just had Anzac Day, and they say, well, this will be the last Anzac Day. You know, many veterans have said, oh, this will be the last Anzac Day that I see, because they're ready to give up and go home to be with the Lord. But the Lord is saying, do not take your life, but give your life to Jesus. Be one of those people that are going to manifest Jesus. Get a different perspective of heavenly places. Get a different perspective of what's on the world. Don't love the things that are in the world. Love the things of God more. And store up your treasures in heaven rather than on earth. I'm getting ahead of myself. All right. We, having the same spirit of faith, according as it is written, I believe and therefore have I spoken. We also believe and therefore we speak. Knowing that, you know, not everybody that believes speaks. But we should be speaking. So rise up and start to speak. You don't need a pulpit. The corner street will do. Coffee shop will do. Wherever you go to meet people, start talking about Jesus. This is the time. The time is now. Evangelism around the world is now. And every person, every born-again believer is responsible for at least one more. So if you've never led somebody to Jesus, do it now. Now is the time. I'm going to say a prayer in a few minutes, and I want you to say it with me, whether you're born again or not. I want you to say this prayer with me so you would remember this prayer, that you would need to use this prayer to get somebody else saved. Get somebody to enter into the kingdom of God, that righteousness, peace and joy in the Holy Ghost that can only come from God, cannot be counterfeited in any way. You can't manifest the fruit of the Spirit. You know, you've got to do it from the inside out, not from the outside in. Okay. He which raised up Jesus shall also raise us up also by Jesus, and shall present us with you. Mm-hmm. For all things are for your sakes, and the abundance of grace might, through the thanksgiving of, may rebound to the glory of God. For which cause we faint not, for though our outward man perish, our inward man are renewed daily. For our light affliction, for our light affliction, it's only a light affliction what we're going through. That's what they're saying. For our light affliction, which is but for a moment, worketh for us a far more exceeding eternal weight of glory. For we look not at the things which are seen, but the things that are not seen. For the things that are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal. For we know that if our earthly house of this tabernacle were dissolved, we have a building of God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. So he's saying that, you know, death is swallowed up in the victory of knowing Jesus. Death is just a momentary light affliction compared to all eternity. So whatever you've got to go through in this life in order to get God, it's worth it. That's what they're saying. Hallelujah. So I said all that to say to you that we should have this. This is the attitude that we should have. But if that don't convince you, just go back and read it all again, but go back to chapter 3. So 2 Corinthians chapter 3, I'll pick it up at verse 2, because it says in verse 2 that you are the epistle written in our hearts, known and read of all men. For as much as you are manifestly declaring to be the epistle of Christ, ministering by us, written not in ink but with the Spirit of the living God, not in tablets of stone but in fleshly tablets of the heart. And such trust we through Christ to God would. Not that our sufficiency is of ourselves to think of anything of ourselves, but our sufficiency is of God, who also has made us able ministers of the New Testament, not of the letter, but of the Spirit. For the letter killeth, but it's the Spirit that gives life. Hallelujah. But if the manifestation of death written and engraven in stones was glorious, so that the children of Israel might not steadfastly behold the face of Moses for the glory of his countenance, which glory was to be done away, how shall not the ministration of the Spirit, but rather the glorious? And if the ministration of condemnation be glory, much more does the ministration of the righteousness exceed in glory. For even that which was made glorious had no glory in this respect, by reason of the glory that excelleth. For if that which is done away was glorious, much more that which remaineth is glorious. Seeing then that we have such hope, we use great plainness of speech, and not as Moses, which put a veil over his face, that the children of Israel could not steadfastly look upon the end of that which is abolished. But their minds were blinded, for unto this day remaineth, and the same veil is untaken in the reading of the Old Testament, which veil is done away in Christ. But even unto this day, when Moses is read, the veil is upon their heart. Nevertheless, when it shall turn to the Lord, the veil shall be taken away. Now the Lord is that Spirit. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. But we all, with open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same glory, into the same image, from glory to glory. Even as by the Spirit of the Lord. Now, what he's actually saying there is that Moses, in old times, Moses used to go up to Mount Sinai and talk to God on behalf of people. And, you know, even today, the people that go to church and they say, they listen to the pastors, they listen to the preacher, and they're quite happy with what the preacher says. And they're happy with that. They will not do their own investigation. They won't read the word for themselves, but they'll just believe whatever the pastor says. Well, over the years, people have been deceived, and of course, the around America, the word of faith has been manipulated and taken advantage of. People have been taken advantage of, and you know, that's the and it's been for money. Deceitfulness has been for money, and that has to stop. We all need to get into the Word and have our own personal relationship with God, and we can all do that, because there are many other deceptions, not just money. Many other deceptions. Money is the root of all evil, of course. The love of money is the root of all evil, and of course evil has got into the churches through the love of money. However, there's many other evils that we need to be aware of, and the only way to protect yourself is to have your own relationship with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through his word. Jesus and the word are one. Can you say that with me? Jesus and the word are one. So if you're in love with Jesus, you've got to be in love with his word. If you love this word, you're going to understand it, it's going to protect you, it's going to guide you, and you're going to be led by the Spirit. And the glory that we're told, you know, we've been told for years that the glory God will not share with another. And your righteousness is of filthy rags, which is, both of those scriptures in Isaiah are true for that time. Our righteousness is of filthy rags in that time. But we're not wearing our righteousness, we're wearing the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. In Corinthians, it says, he who knew no sin was made sin for us, that we would become the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. When does that happen? When we get to heaven, or does it happen now? You must become the righteousness of God right here, right now. Jesus said, unless your righteousness exceeds that of a Pharisee, you'll not be worthy of the kingdom of God. So we have to learn to put on righteousness. We have to learn to put on the glory of God. In John 17, Jesus says, all heaven and earth, all authority in heaven and in earth has been given to me. Now I'm telling you, you go with my word. You go with my glory. The glory that I had from the beginning, I now give you. And it says that you are blessed because I've been with you. And you have seen what I do. But I haven't done anything that I haven't seen the Father do. It's his ministry, see. Now you go in Jesus' name and you do what Jesus done. But he says that you bless because I've been with you, but blessed are those that believe on you through your word. Blessed are those more who have not seen. He's talking about us. Now we have to manifest Jesus so the world can see. Because if they don't see Jesus in you, then they're not going to see Jesus when he comes in the clouds. It'll be too late by that time. And this 2 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 2 says that you are the epistles, our epistles, written in our hearts, known and read of all men. If the world do not see Jesus in you, they're not going to receive Jesus. They're not going to read the Bible. They're going to read you. So are you a believer today? Are you receiving Jesus today? And if you say, well, I've been a believer all my life, but I've never had this born-again experience, do it now. You could say, well, I've seen it in the Word, healing, but I've never received it myself. Receive it now. You could say, well, I've been in one of these denominations that believe in Jesus, but I've never received the Holy Ghost and talking in tongues. Do it now. Whatever you are lacking in your life, reach out to Jesus right now. I want you to say this prayer with me. Heavenly Father, I believe in Jesus.
I believe Jesus died for me.
And rose again from the dead. I accept you as my Lord. And my Savior.
Come into my heart.
And make me born again. Forgive me all my sins. I believe I receive. Right now.
In Jesus' name.
Hallelujah. Rejoice in the Lord. Hallelujah. We're going to ask my wife to come forth, and she's going to sing us a song of rejoice in Jesus' name. If you have received Jesus today, please just let us know. There'll be a message on the screen there with an email address. Send us an email so we can send you some of our literature and bless you in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Be back in soon.
Hello. Good afternoon to each everyone. Those who are watching us in Facebook, welcome to our church today. And also my friends or maybe relatives or families from Philippines, welcome. Before I'm going to sing a song, I would like to give you the encouraging words. We are created by Almighty God to live a blessed and fulfilled life. But so many people live far below of what God truly intends for them simply because they don't see how it could happen. The truth is that you have to believe before you ever going to see something take place in the natural. We have to look with our eyes of faith because of provision, healing, and miracle that we need. You might say, well, I don't know how to do that. I don't know how to look with the eyes of faith. The way you open our eyes of faith is by reading and meditating the Word of God. His Word deposits a faith inside of you and illuminates our heart. His Word causes our faith to grow so we can believe His promises. I would like to sing a song, There Can Be Miracle, when you believe. Today, faith you faith by meditating His Word. Declare His promises over your life.
Many nights we pray with no proof.
to swiftly blown away. Yet now I'm standing here, my heart so full, I can't explain. Seeking faith and speaking words I never thought I'd say. There can be miracles when you somehow you will. You will when you believe. It don't always happen when you ask, and it's to give in into your fears. But when you're blinded by your pain, can see the way get through the rain. But small but still very silent voice says hope is very near. There can be miracles when you
song, beautiful lady, that's my wife, Eleanette Cusa Richards. You can see her on the YouTube. She had many, many songs that she sang. Now we have a special treat. My son is going to come and read a couple of pages from one of my books. The latest book that we put together was Are You in Christ? And there's a particular chapter towards the end of the book is Born to Love, which we're all born to love. And it's through this love that we have in our heart where the anointing flows. So if you're in love with Jesus, every bitter word is sweet. In other words, if you've been disciplined by the Spirit of God, because you're in love, you'll receive that discipline and you'll discipline others in love. You'll be corrected in love. Can you come forth now, my son, Joshua Richards? Hallelujah.
Hello, my name is Josh and Brian Richards. Today, I'm going to be reading Are You in Christ? You can buy this book at trackgood@2.com. More books at trackgood@3.com. If you'd like to subscribe to Dad's mailing list, you can go to revbrianrichards.com.au. Today, I'm going to reading pages 158-160. Your claim to fame is that you are loved by God. And it is an insult to him when you don't know and believe that. One day, Jesus and his disciples were in a boat, crossing over to the other side of the sea. And a great windstorm arose, and the waves beat into the boat, so that it was already filling. But he was in the stern, asleep on a pillow, and they awoke him and said, Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing? Mark chapter 4, verses 37. These disciples questioned whether or not Jesus loved them, and fear gripped their heart. After rebuking the storm and a great calm fell upon the water, Jesus turned to his disciples and said to them, Why are you so fearful? How is it that you have no faith? And they feared exceedingly. One way to know if you truly believe God loves you is whether or not there is fear in your life. If you fear you won't be able to pay your bills this month, then you are not fully convinced in your heart that God loves you. If cancer runs in your family and you fear that one day you'll catch this dreaded disease, then you are not totally persuaded that God loves you as much as he loves Jesus. But if you're walking in love, you'll have no fear. 1 John chapter 4 verse 18 says, There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear, because fear involves torment, but he who fears has not been made perfect in love. Faith works by knowing how much God loves you. Faith works through love, and this is the key to your victory in life, and for overcoming the trials that come your way. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6 tells us, But without faith, it is impossible to please God. For he who comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. The Message Bible says, It's impossible to please God apart from faith. And why? Because anyone who wants to approach God must believe both that he exists and that he cares enough to respond to those who seek him. Faith is a choice. You choose to believe in the goodness of God and that he is, and that he will reward you if you seek him diligently. David wrote in Psalms chapter 27 verse 13, I would have lost heart unless I had believed that I would see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Faith is activated and works by love, and it's this perfect love that will cast fear out of your life. The word cast means to throw out, not caring where it lands. Without fear in your life, you won't be afraid of the devil, people, death, car crashes, cancer, or of losing your job. Paul wrote in 2 Timothy chapter 1 verse 7, For God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. When you're fearless, you're a problem to the devil because he can't scare you. Romans chapter 8 verses 37 says to you, are more than conquerors through him who loves us. God's love gives you the victory every time. Paul writes, Now thanks be to God who always led us in triumph in Christ. The closer you walk with God, the more he'll manifest his love in your life. Just walk outside and look around, and you'll see the goodness of God fully displayed. All that you see, he made for you. That will now come back on.
Very good.
Thank you, Joshua. That was a very good reading. And we have slowly coming to the end of our hour. And we try to keep it under the hour because it's good for uploading. But right now, I want you to remember us in your prayers. Pray for us that we would be led by the Spirit to either come to you. You must be praying for us that we would come to you if you're praying for us and God makes a way to come, then we will come. And so we want you to know that this coronavirus and what is happening around the world now, it could be Matthew 24, where it talks about the things concerning the end, when does the end come. And the end of the world system is not the end of the world, you understand? However, at the time now, I believe that we are going through a change, and the social distancing that we've all experienced around the world is only just the beginning. I don't believe anything will be the same again, come back to being the same again, because the world has learned that if the government agencies around the world come together, they can actually discipline the whole world and bring things under control of governing bodies. And so the one world government that people have talked about is quite possible now, because they've proven to themselves and proven that they can take control of their countries. And so the Bible talks about the one money system and the control of the one money system. And over the years we've been saying, well, you know, the mark of the beast, the 666 comes in, the barcode come and gone, you know, we've lived through it and no 666 has come from that. And so where is the mark of the beast? Well, it is coming, and but it's not coming in a way that we think. There's no barcode where it says 666 is in the barcode. There's no nobody wanted to put a mark on the back of my hand or the top of my head, like the Bible says. In Revelations it says that the mark of the beast is either on the forehead or the back of the hand, and it means that the things that we think on and the work that we do are either marked by the world system or they are controlled by faith system. And that's the decision that we must make very soon, that we're not going to go the ways of the world. We're going to believe God. And for that believing, God is going to divinely protect us. And if there's going to be a buying and selling without this mark of the beast, as they call it, you won't be able to buy and sell. Well, lots of people says that before that happens, Jesus will come back for us in a rapture. Well, yeah. And so they have what they call a post-trib, a pre-trib, a post-trib, and the tribulation, the rapture at the end of the tribulation. Some say it's before the tribulation. Some people say in the middle. The tribulation would be raptured out of it. And rapture simply means a catching away. And I do believe with all my heart that whether you believe in a rapture or not, a catching away shall happen, and it has already started to happen. God is withdrawing from the evil of this world, is withdrawing his spirit. So the catching away has already started. And everybody who is led of the Spirit of God, they know this in their heart. And the drawing away of the Spirit is being taken, the Spirit of God is being taken out of the world right now. And the tribulation, the 7-year tribulation, I believe has started right now. So those who talk about a pre-tribulation rapture, they must be ready to go right now. And this is not nothing to fear about, because if you love Jesus, then you're going to be with Jesus. Whether it's sooner or later, it makes no difference. But I believe the tribulation period has begun through this coronavirus. And if I am right, then 2030 would be all over. By that time, Jesus would have returned by that time. And so, you know, don't plan on buying that big fancy boat or the big fancy house. Store up your treasures in heaven and put your money into commodities. Because if they could take the money away just like that, I mean, they're giving money away right now. All over the world, they're giving money away. It's because they know that the money would be worthless this time next year. You probably won't have cash money. It'd be all the cashless society. And so all the cash will be done away with. If you've got your money in commodities, and you're not holding on to it, then you're fit for the kingdom of God, which is righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. And with God, all things are possible to those who believe. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So believe God for the best, but be ready. This is what I say. Be ready, for the man is coming back. And you just be ready, have clean heart, clean hands, pure heart, and the right motive before God, and you shall see God in your life. And when he comes back, we shall know him, because we'll be like him. In the moment of a twinkling of an eye, we shall be changed. But some are changing right now. Are you ready? Hallelujah. Let the Spirit of the Lord quicken to you that which is holy and that which is blessed. And his word is blessed. His word is what is going to teach you, and is going to discipline you and change you from glory to glory. I'll see you, if I don't see you next week, I'll see you at the top. Amen. God bless you.
Show you I can do anything.